One of the earliest high-energy particle accelerators was the cyclotron. The cyclotron was developed by Ernest O. Lawrence in 1930, and it basically uses electric and magnetic fields to accelerate particles, usually protons, to very high velocities and very high energies. Now, although modern-day high-energy particles are much more complicated than the cyclotron is still used in medicine to treat tumors. So let's take a look at the following diagram that basically describes the structure of our cyclotron and how it actually works. So basically, we have some type of device that creates a magnetic field. So we have two vacuum chambers, vacuum chamber number one and semicircular vacuum chamber number two. Now, within these vacuum chambers, we have a magnetic field that exists. And in this case, the magnetic field points into the board, and that is shown by these blue X's with the circle around them. Now, between our two semicircular vacuum chambers, we have a space. And within this space, between these two points, we create an electric potential difference, a voltage difference. And this voltage difference basically creates an electric field as shown by these green arrows. So for this particular moment, or this particular moment in time, the electric field points in this direction from left to right. Now that means that this part has a positive charge and this part has a negative charge. Now, let's suppose we take our particle, let's say a proton, and we place the proton in this location into chamber one. So we give it some velocity, and when a charged particle, in this case the proton, travels inside a magnetic field, what will happen is the magnetic field will basically create a magnetic force that will act on our charged particle. And because the velocity vector is perpendicular to the magnetic field, the magnetic force will be perpendicular to both the velocity and our magnetic field, and that means that magnetic force will act to create centripetal acceleration. So that magnetic force will cause the proton to move in a circular pathway when that proton is within these two vacuum chambers. So when the proton is in either one of the two vacuum chambers, the magnitude of velocity does not actually change. However, when the proton travels within this space where we have our electric field, there the velocity will increase because the electric force as a result of that electric field will cause that velocity to increase. So when the particle travels between this midsection, its velocity will increase, and when the velocity of a particle moving in a circle increases, the radius of curvature, the radius of that circle, will also increase. And so initially the radius is some small radius. When it accelerates, the radius increases, and this basically continues until the radius is large enough and the velocity is great enough and the energy is great enough that the particle actually exits our cyclotron. And when the particle exits, we can place some type of target object here, for example a tumor, and that particle will collide with that target object. So once again, a particle such as a proton begins from rest. It begins to move in the vacuum chambers as shown. Two chambers are separated by distance as shown in this diagram, and in this space, in this region here, we have an electric potential difference that creates an electric field that is used to accelerate that proton linearly. Now, the magnetic field inside the two chambers keeps the proton moving in a circular pathway. It doesn't actually increase the magnitude of the velocity. Now, as the speed of the proton increases, its radius of curvature also increases, and eventually, as we see in the diagram, the proton leaves the chamber and collides with our target. So if we're using this to treat a tumor, we can place a tumor in this section. Now, notice an important point. So when the proton begins to move initially as it exits and begins to travel through the space, the electric field has to point this way to accelerate the proton in this direction, in the same direction as motion. But when the proton finishes the second semicircular loop, when it exits and begins to travel this way, we don't want that electric field to point in this direction, because that will actually stop it. Instead, we want the electric field to point in the opposite direction. And so to create that type of alternating electric field, we use an alternating electric current. So the voltage source is an alternating voltage source. And it turns out that to keep our electric field changing every half a cycle, we want the frequency of the voltage source to be the same as the frequency of our particle. So once again, notice that the voltage source is alternating. This is because the electric field lines must change directions for the proton to continue on its acceleration pathway. This implies that the frequency of oscillation of the voltage equals to the frequency of the proton along its circular pathway. And this frequency is known as the cyclotron frequency. So what exactly is the equation that gives us the cyclotron frequency? Well, let's begin by recalling what happens inside our two chambers. So whenever we have a positive charge that is moving with the velocity v inside a magnetic field B, and the magnetic field is perpendicular to our velocity, that will create a magnetic force on that object, the charge. The magnetic force will be perpendicular, and the magnitude is given by this equation. The magnetic force acting on the charge is equal to the charge of that particle Q multiplied by its velocity multiplied by its magnetic field. Now, to find the direction, we can apply right-hand rule. So basically, this is our particle. Our velocity is going this way. The magnetic field points into the board. So that means we take the right hand, we point it this way in the direction of the velocity. We curl our fingers into the board to curl the fingers into our magnetic field. Extend the thumb. The thumb points in the direction of our magnetic force, as shown in this diagram. Now, let's begin by applying Newton's second law of motion. So the net force acting on the particle is equal to the mass times its acceleration. Now, because our object is accelerating in a circular fashion, that means A is equal to V squared divided by R, where V squared divided by R is the centripetal acceleration. The force is given by the magnetic force, QVB. So let's take this equation and solve for the velocity. The velocity is equal to QRB divided by M. Notice one of the V's will cancel out. Now, how exactly can we find the frequency? Well, recall that frequency is related to the period. So if we find the period, we can find the frequency. So what exactly is the period? Well, the period is simply the amount of time it takes our particle to travel one full cycle. So that means to calculate the period t, we take the distance it travels in one circle divided by its velocity. The distance is 2 pi r, where r is the radius of the circle. So this is our circumference, and we divide that by the velocity obtained in this in part 1. So we have 2 pi r divided by QRB divided by m. The m will go on top, the r's cancel, and t, the period, is equal to 2 pi m divided by q multiplied by b. Now recall that the frequency is equal to 1 divided by the period. So frequency is equal to 1 divided by t. So we plug in this equation for t, we get this. So we see that the cyclotron frequency is equal to QB divided by 2 multiplied by m multiplied by pi.